we see two school of thoughts that have been formed, or two methodologies has been formed, or two discipline has been formed, one in Iraq and one in Hijaz. We have mentioned that Iraq became very important from the time of Ali ibn Abi Talib. It was like the gate to the east. Umar ibn al-Khattab felt its importance, and he built al-Basra and al-Kufa. Al-Basra was built by Utbah ibn Ghazwan, and Kufa was built by Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. And it became the capital in the time of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And it has thousands of the Sahaba who lived there and a lot of knowledge there. In the Kufa and Iraq, the discipline or the school of thought of Ar-Ra'i, which is informed, knowledgeable in the Quran and the Sunnah, opinion, okay? So we call it Madrasatu Ar-Ra'i. And the teacher or the guru of that school of thought was Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Because when that issue or that disease come, wad al-hadith, or fabricating statements and attributing them to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam started, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was very keen. He said, if I have a problem with the hadith and I'm not sure it is authentic, I'd rather to make my ijtihad and make a fall or make a wrong decision than to put that hadith and say, qala Rasulullah, and Rasulullah did not say that, and make it part of the deen. Okay? So that doesn't mean they don't follow the hadith, as many people want to say that ra'i means everyone give an opinion on his own whim. And this is the furthest from the truth. Anyone can say that, you know. A ra'i based on not the mob opinion, it's the opinion of those knowledgeable people in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And of course, from that school of thought came Ibrahim al-Nakhai and Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman and Abu Hanifa. May Allah be pleased with all of them. While in the Hijaz, and we know great number of the Sahaba lived there, especially Aisha, Umm al-Mu'mineen, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, beloved wife, and Abdullah ibn Umar. I'm mentioning these because they were the three of the most who narrated the hadith, and Abu Huraira. Of course, Ibn Abbas and the rest, there were tons of the Sahaba lived in Medina. So in the Medina, the interest was to collect the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we don't want to go into details about the issue of the Senad and the strength of the men and so on, but this is what happened. So the people of the Hijaz, or the school of thought, the Hijaz, called Madrasatul Al-Athar, or Madrasat Al-Riwaya, or Madrasat Al-Hadith. And in that environment, we know Imam Malik lived. And that's why he is called the Imam of the Hadith. And two of the great scholars who started from Kufa, and they were friends of Abu Hanifa, they moved to Mecca and they lived there. Then they lost their citizenship to Kufa and they became Hijazi ulama, and I mean Sufyan al-Thawri and Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Those were of Ahl al-Hadith, and they were very monumental in strengthening and collecting and organizing the Hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why Imam Shafi'i has mentioned that if it wasn't for Malik and Sufyan ibn Uyayna, he means in his statement, the Hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Hijaz would have been lost. So they were very keen on the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After that stage, this is the fourth stage of the tashri', the evolving tashri', fiqh, came the great tabi'i, التابعين تابعي تابعي التابعين who did work you never can imagine. And those were the scholars who created the science or the discipline of al-jarh wa-ta'dil, who they scrutinized every person in the chain of narration. I mean, even if he said a lie in a joking setting, has nothing to do with the hadith and so on, they would reject it. Started with Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Sufyan and Malik and Ahmad, they had this monumental work before Imam Bukhari and Muslim and Tirmidhi and they come. You know, those they found treasures of the hadith been already collected. Collected from the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Then we know that Sufyan has book, Thawri and Sufyan ibn Uyayna, and Malik ibn Anas has Al-Muwaffa. And we know that others had their own Musnad. And Ahmad ibn Hanbal made the greatest efforts in his book, Al-Musnad. And by the way, it's the only book which we arrived from all those Masanid. Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And what is the meaning of Musnad? He organized the book according to the individual who narrated the hadith. So you find Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, what did he mention? Umar ibn al-Khattab, what did he mention? Aisha, what did she? So all of them and their students. So it becomes easy to know who is who and who met whom. So Musnad ibn Ahmad ibn Hanbal came in that period is the beginning. And that level of the fifth level, we have those encyclopedic writings. We have the great work of Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim and the Tirmidhi and Abu Dawud and al-Nasa'i and many other. But we know that those six books of fiqh, of hadith collection, the most authentic in our deen, in our history, and they came also together in the same probably 50 years of time. So all of them died within 10 years of each other. So they were also in the same time. That time, 300, the things had changed. Politically, the whole Muslim Ummah had divided into many, many identities and countries. And with the end of that period came the total destruction of the Abbasid dynasty by the Hulako and the Tatar in the year 500 or so. In that period, we do have the school of thought took the form more rigid and like more a structure which is you find from the students. They're not the work of the imams. By the way, most of the trouble of the school of thought came from lousy students who became either zealots or narrow-minded.